Mr. President, I have been an OFW for 25 years, Hong Kong, London, and Singapore. And having worked with two global news organizations, I've been exposed to the best practices of various governments in the region and around the world. Good governance, transparency, and accountability. The Filipino people really want to know, from your 8 overseas trips in the last 7 months, how much have you spent per trip? Indonesia, Singapore, when you went to Europe, to China, and here in Davos, and the number of people in your official and unofficial entourage list. Para lang klaro po sa ating mamamayang Pilipino.
Well, I don't have the figures. I'm sure their figures are somewhere. But
pero will it eventually be revealed, Mr. President,
well,
for the Filipino people?
Once we've calculated everything, because this last trip, of course, was just we just finished during the weekend, and we came back on Saturday. So on terms of the cost, you know, the way I see it, you have to look at it as ROI. Do we bring something back or do we not? If you say, I don't know the exact figures of the costs and everything. But, for example, we came back from China with pledges of 22 billion. Mm. Let's say we get actual out of that 1 billion. Bawing-bawi lahat ng 8 trips. Mm. Finished. That's the idea. And we did not only go to China. We went to Davos. We went to the EU. We went to ASEAN. We went to APEC. So in each of those, many pledges were signed. And as I said, it is up to us. Now, the measure of success will be, you know, the cost benefit, very simple. Mm-hmm. How much effort did you put into it? It's not just the money. It's the time that you put into it. Mm-hmm. It's the time and the effort that goes into it is really, that's what I was trying to explain earlier. The reason that we have everyone on the delegation, actually the official delegation is just myself and the cabinet ministers. Then they have staff. So the rest are security. And the others that have been accompanying me are actually private sector. They don't actually fly with me. They go there on their own. Although they are included in our meetings, and they have their own meetings on the sidelines as well. So again, the way I approach it is ROI. How much did you spend? How much did you get? And again, as I'm saying, if we get just one of the MOUs, isa lang. Mm-hmm. And napakahina naman natin if isa lang ang makuha natin. Hindi namin ginagawa trabaho namin kung yun lang ang isa lang makuha natin. But sabihin na lang natin, isa lang ang makuha natin. Bawi na lahat ng trip ko.
Pero Mr. President, sinasabi rin ng mga kritiko that no matter how the government tries to invite investors to the country, but if there's a lack of transparency, accountability, the country does not really invite confidence.
I fully agree. So we will have transparency.
Ililista ba ninyo? Ililista ba ninyo yung gastos, Mr. President?
So there will be accountability and transparency in everything that we do. That's the axiomatic. You know, who's going to argue with that? But it has not been an issue that the private businesses bring up. They bring up ease of doing business. They bring up the cost of energy. They bring up the problems of legislative guarantees. Ang legislative, lalo na sa PPPs, legislative guarantees, ibig sabihin na sa gitna ng project nila, papalitan yung batas, hindi nakikita yung project nila. Pero pilit pa rin silang tapusin. Yun, yung mga nangyayari daw. Yan ang mga sabi sila, yan ang rinireklamo nila sa Pilipinas. So the critics will have their say, but those who are actually contemplating putting good money into the Philippines have other issues. That is not those, accountability and transparency is not an issue.
Mr. President, you talk about the ease of doing business. Mm. You talk about power rates, which is one of the highest in Asia.
Not anymore. Not anymore. No, Europe is the same now as us.
But what are your plans during your administration to bring this down together with the private sector? Because that is one of the issues that is being raised by many investors around the world.
Now, before, medyo number two na lang ngayon. Dati number one talaga.
Kasi hindi lang itong administration na ito. Even the past administrations have always been promising.
Yeah.
Let's improve the ease of doing business. So, the bureaucracy.
The bureaucracy has to be streamlined. The ease of doing business is because we're talking about trade. So the digitalization is going to be a very important part of that. We have to digitalize customs. We have to digitalize all of these collecting agencies so that the BIR, even the central bank, the payments can be made over the internet. All of those things that we don't do now. We have to remove then any the discretion. It's just kung gawin, if the thing is to lahat ng wala, kahit wala kang kausap na tao, nagagawa mo yung kailangan mo, makuha mo yung lisensya mo, makuha mo yung permit mo, makapagbayad ka nung whatever it is, ng fee, whatever it is to get your papers, whatever it is. So we came up against a very disturbing finding here in the Philippines. The ordinary Filipinos who have connectivity talk to every aspect of their lives through the internet, to the school of the children, to their business, to their friends. And the only entity that they do not talk to over the internet is the government, because the government is not digitalized. So let's digitalize the government, and that will take us a long way to helping in the ease of doing business. Now, the problem of energy is a very major one. It's a very major one because at the bottom of it is simple. The supply of power, the demand for power far exceeds the supply that we are producing. And there's also a problem in distribution, which is why the prices are so high. And that has to be fixed also. But in the long term, once we fix what we can at home, in the long term, and that is one of the things that we will talk about a great deal on these trips, is bringing new power plants into the Philippines. And of course, we are stressing on renewables because we're trying to improve the mix of power generation between traditional and renewables. So that is something, but that's a long term. Anything I start, anything this government starts, we will not see the end. Ang nuclear power plant, 6 years, 7 years. Ang floating wind turbine, 6 years, 7 years, ganun din. Anything is 6 years, 7 years. But we have to start, so that's what we're planning to do. We will start.
Isang tanong na lang, baka kasi hindi na ako makakatanong eh. Mr. President, ang ating utang, 13.6 trillion pesos, ang taas-taas. And our debt-to-service ratio is more than 60%. Paano natin po ipababa ito?
I'm sorry, that's gross. We will pull ourselves out of debt via growth. That really is the
guiding principle to the economic plan.
And through investments and the pledges that you will be focusing on.
Well, yes, make them real so that growth continues to pull us out and then provide new jobs. Now we have to, we're very proud that we're at 4.2% unemployment rate, which is like, you cannot have a recession if your employment rate's that low. But despite that, we still have to make the jobs more higher quality. We have to make them better. These green jobs, which is what we're talking about, and even the new technologies that are going to be used for our OFWs, all of these things, the upskilling, the reskilling, that's all we talk about. That's all, because those are the things that we need to do. It's not one simple thing. There is no silver bullet. We have to do very many things to make it right. Because what we are in fact doing is restructuring the entire Philippine economy to adjust to the new world global economy.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Rico.
Thank you, Rico, for the many questions. Let's move on to Sas Rogando Sasod of SMNI.
Good afternoon, Mr. President.
Good afternoon.
Sas of SMNI News Channel. My first question is related to privatization. Earlier this month, Department of Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista revealed that you have plans to privatize the operations of NAIA. And as we all know, privatizing government assets has been a very contentious issue in our country. For example, the predecessor of your father, former President Corazon Aquino, you know, has been lambasted for privatizing a lot of government assets.
We have no plans to privatize anything. Okay. There's no plan to privatize anything. We'd rather do the opposite. No, when Secretary J.B. Bautista was talking about that, I think he misspoke or he was misinterpreted. But you cannot privatize an airport to begin with. They cannot own the airport. No, a private firm cannot own the airport. At best, kasi na nga nagkakagulo, nagkakaproblema tayo dito sa airport. At again, in New York, meron kaming nakilala, the group that runs Gatwick Airport, they run London Airport, they run several big airports, that we're asking them, what can they do? Can they come in and help us so that we can increase the traffic through the Manila Airport? And they said they could. And so they're coming, they were here last week and to look at the operations of the airport, and especially since we had that problem in New Year's Day and this recent outage with the UPS. So at most, we will have a management contract. Come in and manage the airport. And they say that they, without changing anything, without new equipment, without building a new runway, that they can increase the traffic from what is presently, they refer to as 35 movements per hour, to up to 45 movements per hour, without changing anything. So we want that. And those skills can only be had from this group. And there are several groups, but they can be had from the private sector group who have huge experience in running ports and running airports.
Mr. President, my second question is about foreign policy. You have been very clear and empathic since the start of your administration that you're going to continue the foreign policy doctrine of your predecessor, the friend to all, enemy to none foreign policy doctrine of non-alignment. My question is related to how further you're going to possibly refine or operationalize this doctrine. Does your administration see any opportunity in, for example, deepening engagement with the non-aligned movement, especially now that superpower rivalry, especially in our zone, might be intensifying sometime in the future?
Well, that was very much in response to the Cold War and the slow dismantling of the organs of the Cold War, if that's what you want, if that's how you want to put it, and that is why that non-aligned treaty was created between several nations who said that we no longer subscribe to the notion that we as a country must choose one to side with one superpower or another, and that is precisely what we have undertaken. And that is exactly the position that I have taken in terms of foreign policy. Although this came up again in our discussions in the conference, is the question that was asked was very, very actually thought-provoking. Will geopolitics finally kill globalization? Because geopolitics is pulling people apart and all these aggregations are being pulled apart. And the general conclusion is that countries realize that alliances are important, or in fact they're more than important, they're necessary. Nonetheless, these alliances do not mean that we are, within the sphere of influence of any great power. As a matter of fact, in ASEAN, we all came to the agreement that at the very least, in ASEAN, in the Asia-Pacific region, the future of the region must be decided by those in the region, not by some outside power. And so I think the idea, I do not know of any formal meetings or conferences of the non-aligned nations. They used to have them. They don't have them very much anymore. I don't know about that, but we are very much in the spirit of that treaty. We are very much part of it in the sense that we continue to walk that very fine line between two great superpowers who are surrounding us both physically and geopolitically.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Sas.
Okay. Thank you so much, Sas Reganda Sansot of SMNI. And last but not least, we have Ivan Mayrina of GMA 7.
Mr. President, good afternoon. I'm Ivan Mayrina. I represent GMA Integrated News. Before I proceed to my two questions, I'd like to ask a follow-up question from Cheryl's question earlier about the latest incident in Ayungin Shoal. Mr. President, how do you intend to resolve the seeming disconnect between what gets agreed upon at your level, at the top level, and what gets implemented out at sea? Yeah. I know you said there is no compromise yet, but in the meantime, our fishermen are being prevented from engaging in their livelihood.
Well, I think the actions that are needed are really from the Chinese side. And that is because We do not send Coast Guard boats into what we consider their waters or international waters. They stay within Philippine waters. And so that hopefully, as I said, the reason that it was important for me, let me clarify what we talked about with President Xi. And it was very simple. I said we have to raise the level of discourse between the Philippines and China. Now, we already have a bilateral group that's working on issues about the South China Sea. Now, my proposal is that we bring that bilateral group to a higher level. It's sub-ministerial level ngayon. So let's bring it to a ministerial level. And I will ask my foreign secretary to be part of it. I will ask my ambassador to China to be part of it. And I guarantee you that if there is any decision that needs to be made, either of those gentlemen can pick up the telephone and talk to me. And within 5 minutes, we will have a decision. I hope that China can do the same. And that is what the President Xi was agreeable. And he said, why not? So he assigned his foreign minister to take care of the details. That's what we're working on now. Now, with the power structure in the People's Republic, I think that if the President Xi, puts out an order that we will not do that anymore, we will do something else, then I think it will be. I think the chain of command is fairly solid. Because again, we will be able to report any violations of whatever agreement we come to.
Unang tanong ko pala. Kamakailan po naglabas ng video si First Lady Lisa? Naglabas siya ng warning sa mga taong gumagamit daw ng kanyang pangalan para ma-appoint. Apparently, it had something to do with appointments at the AFP. At sinabi niya, pag ginawa niyo yan, sasabihin ko sa asawa ko, huwag kayong i-appoint. My question, Mr. President, is how involved is the First Lady in your decisions with regard to appointments and in your governance in general?
Zero. She really has no input on that. The First Lady helps me in terms of the organization, because she's actually very, very good at that. Organizing which office, how the workflow goes, where the documents go through. She's a well-trained lawyer, so she's very good at that. But that's the extent of it. We don't talk about we don't talk policy together. I mean, she'll comment. Mm-hmm. She generally say that, you know, that looks good, that doesn't look good, I don't know why you're doing that, that's fine, what a great idea. But that's it.
Do you consult her in difficult decisions?
Not political. Not political decision. Legal. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, the legal, I will ask her. I will ask whenever there's a legal question, I'm not a lawyer, so I need an expert opinion. She's right next to me most of the time, so I can turn to her. I am very lucky, actually. I think I have the best legal representation of any president. I have a former chief justice as my executive secretary. I have JPE, who is working as a legal advisor to the president. And between all of these experts and legal luminaries, that's the only time that that the discussion may include Lisa. But she doesn't come to the office and sit with us at all. Mm-hmm. If I have something to ask her, it's usually definitions. Mm-hmm. Define to me what is the legal definition of this? What is the legal definition of that? When they talk about this, what do they mean? What's the legal concept behind that? It's usually that's the kind of question, because she's a teacher. Mm-hmm. So that's the kind of question I ask her.
Last question, sir. Madalas rin pong isama si Congressman Sandro sa inyong mga biyahe at sa inyong mga engagements. The question is the congressman being groomed as the next Marcos president?
Sandro? No. He's not being... we're not grooming him for anything. He's grooming himself. He has decided on this career and politics, and I he will handle it the way he does. There's not some long range plan that one day Sandro is going to be president. He will laugh in your face if you tell him that. But no, there's no we don't think in those terms. He has worked in Ilocos Norte. Even talk of the presidency would be so premature, and it's not something that we plan. I mean, we'll see. I think he has the same attitude as I do. I'll take this as far. I'll do as well as I can, work as hard as I can, and take this as far as I can, which is exactly what I said. You know, well, like when people talk about did you plan this being to be president? I said, well, you know. I was a congressman. Masarap din siguro magpresidente, no? Governor ba? All these problems na hinaharap ko, maayos ko sana ito kung presidente na ako. Senador, ganun din. Diba? Everybody dreams to be the number one position. But that doesn't mean that we're plotting. we have this long-range plan. Not at all. Not at all. He's too busy anyway. He has too much work anyway. The reason he accompanies us is because he's an author of the Maharlika Bill, the Maharlika Fund Bill, and I had an interview with Financial Times. He took over when it came to the Maharlika Bill because I had somewhere else to go, so siyang nag-explain. Author naman siya, dapat alam niya. So that's one that these recent trips. That's the reason why he has been with us.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Well, on that note, thank you so much, Mr. President. Thank you so much.
One round lang. No
round. Round two. But let's wrap it up. Yeah, thank you so much to our friends in media, our anchors in broadcast media, for being here in our sit-down with Mr. President. And I hope you liked it.